How to Calculate Market Size is the topic of today's presentation. This is also referred to as total addressable market. So estimating total addressable market is a rather difficult chore, and that's why we wanted to have this presentation. There are lots of people out there looking at how one might go about calculating market size or total addressable market. Now, why do we care? Well, we care as investors because this demonstrates the potential for a business to grow. So there's this quote here from a gentleman named Howard Aiken. It says, "Don't worry about people stealing your ideas. If your ideas are any good, you'll have to ram them down people's throats." And indeed, lots of the big businesses today had to push very hard to raise money to realize their vision. And when you go to venture capitalists to raise money, they're early stage investors. They're looking for a couple things. They're looking for growth potential. So that's the maximum amount of revenue that you might be able to realize with your business. And of course, there's other things like profitability, but revenue is a very important indicator of the size of a market. And they're also looking for traction, which shows that you have product market fit. Unless you've managed to grow businesses already and ideally exit them successfully, a venture capitalist won't throw money at you unless you can show them that you're already generating revenue. Shark Tank's a good example of a more minor league application of this idea. The potential for growth of a business is reflected in the market size, which is also called total addressable market. We abbreviate that as TAM, and we use that acronym quite a bit. Now, Blue Ocean TAM, this means you don't have to displace a direct competitor. So with most growth businesses, they're going to be hurting somebody. So Airbnb doesn't have a lot of direct competitors in what they're trying to do, their unique business model, but their indirect competitors, hotels, have really suffered as a result of their success. Uber actually has some direct competitors in various geographies. So if you go to a particular country in Eastern Europe, their Uber app might be named something different, as the same you'll find in Asia. But Uber's indirect competitor that's really suffered, in fact, some countries, you can't take an Uber because it's dangerous. They threaten taxi drivers, and oftentimes taxi drivers form a coalition similar to mafia, and they try to push Uber out. Then you have Amazon, of course. They do have some direct e-commerce competitors, but they're absolutely dominating, and we'll take a look at that. But I wanted to distinguish between some other acronyms here. This is very important. So you often see this term TAM used quite often. Less frequently, you'll see this term serviceable addressable market. So it's important to recognize that you may be limited in what you're actually able to accomplish. So the total addressable market is, of course, globally and everywhere that your business might be able to succeed. Serviceable is limited to your reach, such as the product's functionality, geography. A good example of this would be whether or not you've localized a piece of software so that it can be used in countries where they predominantly speak different languages, such as Japan. That's a developed market where everybody uses a different language other than English, though a good percentage of them can read English. But language is a good example of serviceable available market. And then you have serviceable obtainable market. This is what you can expect to acquire given your go-to-market investment and competition. So that's unique to your business. That's what we really want to know, right? And you often see firms that just throw up total addressable market, but they don't take it down to that level. Now, this diagram I quite liked, but at the bottom, I think this is incorrect. So it says market share. What is our current revenue compared to SAM? No, actually, we believe that's different. So market share should always total 100%. If you have 25% market share, your competitors have the other 75%. Total market share then can be expressed as that total amount as the percentage of TAM captured for all participants. That's a very important thing to distinguish, and it can oftentimes get confusing when you're working with these numbers. But here's an example of somebody that's calculated total available market, and I don't know the business here, but it's quite interesting. They're looking at users here. It looks like Excel users, cloud users of CRM, and cloud users of accounting software. And then they've broken that down to what they think the serviceable available market is. You see 1% of Excel users, 2% of CRM, 10% of accounting. And then they go down here, and they've detailed that as well. They go down here at the bottom and they say 1% of users in the serviceable addressable market fit their target groups and regions. They've identified 125,000 users that they can target. So this sort of exercise is great for an MBA to do. This would be a great project for a class to go out there and find a particular niche and estimate the these various levels. Sources. So we don't have a lot of time to sit around calculating this stuff. You could probably spend an entire semester figuring this stuff out. So we usually look to other sources for total addressable market. You have Mumbai copy shops. You got to be very careful about these research firms out there, dime a dozen firms, lots of them operating out of India, and the research they put out, they know that if they're able to sell one of these $4,500 reports, then that's a lot of money, so they'll pretty much just churn them out as fast as possible. Then you have what the company says, and you need to take that with a grain of salt because they're trying to appeal to investors. You have what their competitors say, and that's useful then, right? Because then you can see what their exaggerated estimates are compared to others' exaggerated estimates. Then you have large, reputable consulting firms. You have to be careful there. They're usually trying to sell something. You have boutique research firms that have some opinions about very niche markets that you may not find information for elsewhere. And then you can make your own estimates. We're going to give an example of that later. We do this with labor. It's quite easy to do. And what you could then do, I suppose, is average all the legitimate sources that you find and come up with a number. Now, what's a reasonable TAM if you're an investor? Well, we're disruptive growth investors, along with investing in dividend growth as well. But on the disruptive growth side, we look for outsized returns and we take a risk-averse approach to tech investing. So we want to make sure that because this theme, tech investing, is so risky, we want to make sure that we're getting bang for our buck. So it's hard to see anything under $10 billion total addressable market being attractive. That's a nice round number indeed, but it's quite small if you consider what success looks like. We'll look at that in a second. Revenues are a proxy for market share captured. So when you look at firms like Amazon here with $500 billion in revenues, they've certainly captured a lot of the e-commerce market, which is intuitive. You see Alphabet there on the bottom with $250 billion. Well, they have pretty much the only search engine that's being used right now that disseminates the world's information, so it's understandable why they've had such a success. So when you look at the revenues coming from firms like this and then you compare that to the $10 billion cutoff we have, we want to really be going for the large opportunities. And of course, it's very difficult to predict what those will be. Here's a look at Amazon's market share of e-commerce in the U.S., and they have, 38% there. But it's interesting that next on the list, you see Walmart, and then it's quite fragmented. Apple, you wouldn't expect to see them. They're Home Depot. Wow. You know, so when you think about Amazon, maybe you might not think of certain competitors they have that aren't so intuitive. Now, we can do a sanity check here. $1 trillion USA e-commerce market. Amazon's North America revenues of $316 billion, roughly in the range there. So you always want to run some sanity checks on your numbers. Now, when we calculate TAM, this is very difficult to do because we want to calculate it before it's been captured. So it's very easy to say, oh, here's the size of a market based on current revenues from all the competition. But if it's blue ocean and we don't know anything about it and we face Rumsfeld's unknown unknowns, it's really a best guess and a sanity check at best, to be honest. But what it does do is force you to distinguish between good ideas and big ideas. And of course, that's what we do. And some of the firms that we look at have very interesting ways of describing their TAM. This is a chart from CrowdStrike. It's an excellent one, and it shows how they've created modules for their offering. And I'm sure some of these components have been acquisitions that they made, but you can see that they break down each module that they're addressing with a product, an existing product, and they step that up from, on the far left, you see that's their core offering, right? Their core security offering. And then they step that up going to the right. So they have these add-ons, and then you see the total addressable market of $76 billion there. That's what it ends up at. And then you can see where they then start forecasting the growth for that total addressable market, because it changes year on year. And of course, you want to see high growth. Over the next couple of years, it's expected to grow in the double digits, and it totals close to $100 billion. So this is a great way to describe your total addressable market so that people can sort of pick it apart. Now, another firm that does something similar is UiPath, though there would have some criticisms perhaps with the way that they're estimating this, but they do a good job here, just about the same TAM size you see in the upper right. Below that, you see where they've broken down along the bottom there. Their current portfolio of products is addressing a $61 billion opportunity, and then future available TAM. These are product offerings they expect to move into that expand that TAM from $60 billion to $93 billion. Now, $60 billion is quite high, and when you look, for example, at Forrester Research, so they're a legitimate research firm, this is an interesting chart that we wouldn't expect to see, and it shows RPA services and software growth over time, and you can see that growth actually expected to lag. This came from an article on TechCrunch that talked about how RPA was going to start seeing growth flatlining, and this would represent about a $25 billion total opportunity, which when you consider UiPath has $1 billion in revenues now, and of course there's competition out there, very formidable competitors, they still have a lot of upside. Now when you look at just some cursory Google searches, things start to get nasty in a hurry. So here's three estimates. Notice here how, you know, Forrester says growth is flatlining, but look at these estimates. So Statista, we use them a fair amount, but you need to be careful there because their business model is to go out and find people with data and then publish, encapsulate it in their consistent look and feel, and then publish that. And I don't know the extent to which they vet their sources. I hope they're not using the Mumbai research shops, at least the ones that are dime a dozen. There are research shops out of India that are competent indeed, but there are more that are incompetent than competent. And second on the list here, Grandview Research, they describe themselves as a Indian and San Francisco shop. And they make it a point, they make it a point in their about us to say, look, we're different. We're not one of those copy shops, and we actually have legitimate research. So they're forecasting this very strong growth. And then along the bottom there, Yahoo Finance. Well, Yahoo Finance doesn't do that research. You have to look and see the source. And that's a firm we hadn't heard of, a research firm. And what they all have in common is they're saying that RPA is expected to grow, what, 27% or higher over the next 9 years, is it? And they're also saying that it's quite small right now. So perhaps these might be more accurate than that Forrester piece, though, as you can see, now you've got three different sources. What do you do? It's very difficult. Well, you need to start thinking through the problem as an investor and using RPA to create efficiencies. That's going to sell in good times and bad. This is the first tier of the AI algorithms automating away jobs. Back and middle office jobs will be the first to go. That's why they went overseas in the first place. UiPath has realized $1 billion in revenue. The question is, how much more upside is that for them? And how easy is it for existing customers to spend more? This is the idea of net retention rate. And this chart they produce in their latest investor deck is quite edifying. You can see in the lower left, well, this is customer size, right? On the left-hand side, along the bottom is the money, the spend. So the farther right you go, the more these customers are spending, the lower they are, the smaller they are. This is pretty interesting. So you see they have a fair number of small customers, their smallest, paying a lot of money, as much as their largest customer. So this has a lot of potential for firms to grow. And I like this chart here that shows their 25 largest customers to date. And you can see where the largest signed on, what, they're in 2015. And then after they had been at it for a couple years, they decided to sign a multi-year contract. Those are those red dots. So ideally, you want to see that red dot right away. That would show they signed a multi-year contract up front. But what you see here is they're trying the solution before they commit. And that's great. That's what you should do. And you can see that they're spending more over time. And their 25th customer there, you see, they tried it and they loved it and they signed a multi-year contract next quarter. That's great to see. The closer those two dots are together, the better. But this shows that their existing customers, their largest, are growing over time and finding this to be more and more useful. So we're quite positive about UiPath's potential. We've written extensively about it. Another example would be SolarEdge. So the market for inverter hardware is really somewhat limited. It's probably right around the $10 billion cutoff that we have in terms of what we would find to be attractive opportunities. But what you can do then is create adjacent verticals that have much larger total addressable markets, ideally a high margin recurring revenue, so they can work on energy storage, solar servicing, solar package solutions. They're doing all that stuff. In particular, energy storage is of interest. But solar is expected to be the dominant form of energy by 2030. It's expected to outpace all other forms of energy, including all the different types of renewables and dirty energy. So that's the overall thesis there, that we've researched extensively how we might get exposure to solar in probably 20 different articles, and arrived at SolarEdge being a firm that we thought provided the best risk versus reward. We're really looking for market leaders who will persist over time as long as solar keeps growing as it's expected to and weather downturns. That's very important. Another example that recently came up, our last research piece, actually, I'll put a link to it in the description of this video, is NovoCure. And this is quite cool. So we were doing a video on their 10K and going through it and analyzing it. And we came across this piece here of information that highlights their three primary markets, US, Germany, and Japan. You can see that they describe the total number of patients in those geographies. And then they point out the patients who are candidates based upon the rate of disease progression and medical eligibility. So they've worked out their serviceable addressable market. And you can see the total patients. Then they tell you the patients that are using the solution. Great. So then you can figure out their implied penetration. Since their solution is unique, they don't have a direct competitor. Their market, they're just trying to capture all that market share. And of course, you need to take into account this is a very expensive solution. And we were able to figure out the revenue per patient by looking at the revenue per region. And then we could calculate an implied TAM. And it's really quite low. You see, it's less than $2 billion. And then they say, well, we have all these other indications that will open up our TAM, and they are acknowledging their TAM is quite small and saying, here's our plan to expand that, which is great. Then there's a Caterpillar example. This was rather recent, and we were trying to figure out the heavy equipment autonomy thesis. And what we did is we went to the U.S. Department of Labor. We looked up equipment operators. How many are there? What's their average salary? Then we had a labor run rate for the autonomy thesis for heavy equipment. It was over $50 billion. But don't forget other efficiencies like lower maintenance costs, more efficient operations. You don't have people taking smoke or lunch breaks. The vehicles are also operated much in a manner where there's less tire wear and things like that. And of course, safety increases. So that all needs to be considered when you're looking at total addressable market. As you can see, it's very complicated. It's an art, not a science. It's a great project for MBAs, but we all don't have the time to sit around calculating TAMs. So we just need to be aware of where we're getting the information that we choose to use when making investment decisions. Most companies are using TAM incorrectly. They're showing you the total opportunity, but they're not breaking it down to say, here's what we can realistically capture right now. True TAM is SAM, which is unique to every company. Now, we're going to continue to use TAM, the terminology, and in hopes that firms grow into the opportunity that they think they will. And of course, take it all with a grain of salt. Our focus on international revenue diversification often or also helps make TAM more accessible in terms of thinking about whether or not a company is going to be able to capture it. So I'm going to put up another video here that you might like to watch, but Before you watch that, please click the Nanalyze logo on the right. Subscribe to our channel. We don't run ads, so we need your help to support us. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today. And like the video, please. Thank you.